The Pale Council is a group of four mysterious foes who can only be encountered by completing prophecy chains. They were introduced in Prophecy League, June of 2016, so they've been around for a long time. Even with their long existence in the game, not much is known about them. Who is the Council? When did they start? What do they want? How do they fit into the greater lore of Path of Exile? The prophecy chains to reach the Pale Council encounter, called the Pale Court, are the Feral Lord, the Plague Maw, the Unbearable Whispers, and the Unbreathing Queen. The name Pale Court gives some hint to who they are. They're a group of rulers working together as equals who seek some judgment or influence. But their actions don't seem to affect the world around them. Besides their introduction in Prophecy, there's been no further ties of the Pale Council to the game's story. With their story so self-contained, what impact has the Pale Council had on Rayclast? Are they a threat, or simply keepers of uniques we might want for ourselves? Nivali gives us the prophecies needed to track down and kill the Pale Council. By completing 5 subsequent prophecies in each chain, we get 1 key for each member of the Council. Nivali doesn't give explicit reasons for this hunt, although she does say that the council members are beyond the sight of her patron, Hinakora, the Karui Mother of Death. Perhaps the simple existence of those who have escaped death is enough justification, or maybe there are more nefarious things at work. Nivali tells us that when the wise red rulers were long dead, the strong seized power. I suspect these red rulers were the Vol, who controlled most of Rayclast in the past, and were certainly the most powerful and predominant peoples of their time. The Vol civilization fell in 400 BIC, BIC being before the conception of the Eternal Empire. The fall happened during the rule of Queen Atsiri, when her thaumaturgist Doryani tried to have communion with the beast under Highgate, causing the first cataclysm. This resulted in devastation across Rayclast similar to what we see in the modern cataclysm caused by Malachi. The land is corrupted, and those killed rise back from the dead. When Nivali says the strong seized power, she's referring to the members of the Council and rulers like them before they had become the Council. It's probable that, after the fall of the Vol, many different people assumed power over the lands and peoples they were near. But these unwise leaders pulled people towards ruin, and Hinakora cast her net towards these new kings and queens. So Hinakora saw the actions of these new rulers on the barren and corrupted Rayclast and attempted to stop them, but 4 slipped through the holes and fled into darkness. There they remain. And these remaining are the members of the Pale Council. The Pale Council consists of Iriel, Eber, Inya, and Volker. Iriel is the Feral Lord, Lord of the Wild. Iriel's people suffered as the rain stopped, killing their crops. His solution was to use the blood of beasts nearby to water the crops, but as we've seen, the corruption of a cataclysm affects the beasts as well as the land and people. This corrupted blood caused the crops to tower, monstrous and thorned, and it seems the people who feasted on his crops were turned feral and monstrous from their consumption. The Feral Lord's prophecy chains take place in woods, the Dried Lake, Sarn, and focus on beasts and hunting. Iriel believes that ferocity must be learned, not taught. Eber is the Plague Maw, Mouth of the Masses. Eber and his people suffered a similar plight to Iriel in that the barren landscape was starving his people. Eber's solution was cannibalism. Nivali says, if you don't feed an animal, it will soon cast a hungry eye upon its brothers and sisters, and man is no different. He feeds the starving with the starved, the strong with the weak. The flavor text of the second prophecy in the Plague Maw chain says his followers feed on the flesh of the dead, a desecration of the Mother's work. This indicates that our quest to defeat the Pale Council is for Hinakora's revenge, since these 4 escaped her, and cannibalism is an affront to Hinakora's reverence for death. His prophecies are located in areas tied to thaumaturgy and leaders, such as the crypt and the crystal veins, but also importantly Vol's side areas, which supports that the Pale Council came after the fall of the Vol. But they do have more modern locations, like the Imperial Gardens that surround the Scepter of God. Could the Council, in their escape from death, have had influence on more modern people and actions? His unique item's flavor text could suggest that the council wants to spread their power. I exhale and you inhale, and inexorably we inch towards oneness. Inya is the unbearable whispers, the infinite mind. Her prophecy chains especially imply that the council, even if they were incepted after the fall of the Vol, have had influence on more recent figures. Inya was a queen with an unending thirst for learning, but wisdom and knowledge are not one and the same. She read countless books until the point that she lost touch with reality. Her prophecy chains are about tomes that we find, even if there's only one we can actually read. This dark tome, which we fittingly find in the Sarn Library, tells us Inya discovered a book that illustrates forbidden techniques used to prolong life far beyond ordinary means. We'll look more into what this tome says and what it might actually be. The locations of her prophecies are around areas of learning and power, like the library, but also the Scepter of God and even the Lord's Labyrinth. Most interestingly, her third prophecy has us kill Chevron, who apparently has one of Inya's tomes. Did Chevron have this book before her death when she worked alongside Malachi to utilize the nightmare? Chevron is known to have books. In fact, her fights even utilize books as weapons against us. Our first encounter with Piety in the prison, Piety is reading a journal left by Chevron that details how Chevron turned Brutus into the monster he is now. It's possible that Inya's books were studied by Chevron. We can't read what's in this book, so we can't know if it was a book that Inya wrote or that simply belonged to her. Inya's key does say that Inya's every word stands our hair on end, which implies she wrote as well as read. It's entirely possible that Inya's studies and her knowledge had an impact on Chevron and her own thaumaturgical works and horrors. The final member of the Pale Council is Volker, the Unbreathing Queen, she of many bodies. Volker was interested in necromancy and turned many dead into an army of soulless corpses. Volker's actions had already mocked death, likely getting the most attention and wrath from Hina Kora. Volker's guidance gloves say, "You do not cease to be when you die, any more than a caterpillar ceases to be when it cocoons. Come, let me show you." This is another hint that the council is using people for something. Her prophecy chain focuses on places where heroes died that she has now raised. This includes Waylon, the Ezemite challenger who fought alongside Chittis in Izaro's labyrinth. Chittis used Waylon, who was much stronger than him, as a tool to overcome the labyrinth. Chittis and his uncle Kadiro had bribed people working on building Izaro's lab to plant supplies for Chittis and give Chittis a map of the labyrinth and its traps. Together, Waylon and Chittis were able to defeat the labyrinth, but Chittis poisoned Waylon so that there would be no fight, which Chittis would obviously lose, and he could ascend to the Eternal Throne. Volker has used her necromancy on the corpses of important or heroic figures, and ones that existed long after her own time, if the Pale Council originated after the fall of the Vol. So the Council is certainly meddling in the lives of recent figures, influencing knowledge and using the souls of heroes to some end. Even though Volker is the Council member interested in necromancy, it was Inya who inspired the Council to escape from death. Her dark tome describes how this was done. First, it starts off with "the sky turns black as ink," which suggests these actions were taken not long after the fall itself. Black and the Cataclysm or Nightmare are often associated. Victorio, the people's poet, dubs Malachi the blackest monkey in his parable about Malachi and Chittis. Chittis is the Monkey King, for comparison. Malachi was absolutely steeped in Nightmare and was persuading Chittis to become more and more entrenched in the powers of Thaumaturgy and Nightmare. Tasuni describes Malachi, in current day, as residing in the black heart of the beast. Lavianga, advisor to King Kaum, wrote about Lyanai's watch after the Cataclysm on weathered carvings. He wrote that black storms descend on us from the north, and north is where Highgate and the beast reside. He also said that the storm withers our crops and sickens our livestock, which are very similar symptoms to what the members of the Pale Council and their people suffered before they actually became the Pale Council. The book Enya found describes how to fracture their souls so that each of them has a part of the other's soul, and that will keep them eternally connected. This is likely why they are equal parts of a council, rather than having one particular leader. Each of them is inextricably connected to the other. In fact, in the Pale Court fight, you have to kill all of them to be able to kill any of them completely. Each council member becomes vulnerable in turns, while the others are completely invulnerable to your attacks. To be able to split their souls and create this bond, they needed to find others to sacrifice. The council used the strongest or most vital people in their own realms to sacrifice to create this soul bond. Bring your most loyal and healthy retainers. Maybe this is why Volker continues to find the bodies of heroes across Rayclast. Grip of the Council Glove's flavor text says, "Death does not remove you from our grasp. Death only brings you closer." This confirms that the Council is finding people who have died and using them, but if they're already dead, they can't be sacrificed. So what is the Council doing with them? Is Volker just gathering more corpses for her army? Finally, in this tome, Enya writes that immortality is within our grasp, but there are those who would kill for this chance at eternal life. This can't refer to Hinakora, as she would have no interest in immortality, being the goddess of the underworld and mother of death. Perhaps there were people trying to stop the council who were also mortals, or maybe Enya just feared that such powerful knowledge would attract those who would kill for it. We have seen examples of immortality in mortals in Path of Exile. Recently, Katarina, leader of the Immortal Syndicate, and before her, Zerfi of the Vol. Could one of these be the source of Enya's knowledge? First, let's look at the Immortal Syndicate. Katarina took an artifact from the Order of the Djinn, called the Horns of Kulamak, which siphon the very breath of life from any living thing and are thought to be the ultimate tool of life and death. Obviously, these horns are not a book. But in Katarina's Lifegiver Manifesto, she does write that those that die for our cause will live on within us, which is very similar to what the Council has done. They have taken their most worthy followers as sacrifice to create this immortal bond between them. They also have pieces of each other's souls within themselves. Katarina also writes that each sacrifice we must make is but a twig in the flames of our forge. I can't be absolutely certain that sacrifice here means of people, rather than of decision, but in context of the first quote, it very well could be. Also, the Order of the Djinn has been around for an extremely long time, at least before the founding of the Eternal Empire, 400 years after the fall of the Vol, as one of their members, Egrin, had visions that inspired Tarkus Veruso to descend from the Asmerian mountain ranges to found the Empire. This does leave a 400-year gap for the Order to have been formed, the Horns of Kulamak to have been found, and someone to have written about its powers. If the Order was founded before, or just after, the Fall, a book written about the Horns could be what Enya is referencing. I think it's more likely that the book Enya found is tied to Zerfi, who lived before Queen Atziri, therefore before the Fall of the Vol. Zerfi was alive for 168 years, finding young and virile victims to sacrifice in a ritual that not only extended his life, but kept him young. An issue is that Zerfi was found dead next to his 13th victim. Something must have gone wrong, as all of Zerfi's previous victims had been horribly tortured and mangled before their death, and this 13th victim, although still dead, was unmolested and unmutilated. Atziri was so infatuated with Zerfi's power that her main motivation for employing Doriani, her thaumaturgist, was to discover how Zerfi had found this immortality. While she never found his ritual, it's possible Enya did. There are some uncertainties here. Zerfi's immortality relies on continuously killing victims and brutally torturing them, the latter being essential to the success of the ritual, apparently. There's no explicit mention of torture in Enya's tome. However, Enya does say that the Council must choose their most loyal and healthy followers as sacrifice, and that life granted requires life to be paid, which does sound like what Zerfi did. And Enya having a fear that people would seek this knowledge and kill for it could be because Adziri, for years, had been single-mindedly trying to find this ritual. If Adziri had been alive after the fall, she certainly would have killed the Council for this knowledge, and it's likely her obsessed pursuit made many others aware of the existence of Xerfi and his missing ritual knowledge. In addition, the expansion that introduced Adziri, Sacrifice of the Vol, started in 2014, so long before Prophecy and the Pale Council in 2016. Betrayal League, which introduced the Immortal Syndicate and the Order of the Djinn, didn't happen until the end of 2018. It's more likely that the reference of existing knowledge of immortality would reflect a story that was already in the game, rather than one coming out 2 years later. Regardless of the source of Enya's knowledge, the Council used this information to sacrifice the chosen best of their followers and escape death. One big missing piece is why. The most obvious answer is so they could survive and avoid the ravages of the Cataclysm. If that was the initial goal, do they have any goals now besides continuing their lives? Is their mission simply to stay out of the reaches of Hinakora and death? This is where we don't have answers. At first, I thought that Cosprey and Mauritius, two characters introduced in item flavor text that talk of the Council, might have some clues. Unfortunately, it seems that the creator of these four items, Lost Arts, has explicitly stated that the Council in these is not the Pale Council. We can assume that the raising of dead heroes and bestowing of knowledge to dangerous thaumaturges was done with some goal in mind by the Council. As for their name and the Pale Court they reside in, I think their main judgment is on who is worthy to be sacrificed or utilized by them. Until there is some further action taken by the Pale Council, their significance and motivations will remain a mystery. The mind of the Council reads, "You think we do not know. We know all that you think." What I think is that the Pale Council needs to be revisited, or dealt with once and for all. That was Sunday. But thank you so much for watching. It's your boy Noodle. This video was voted on by patrons, so if you like these videos, consider becoming a patron, or at least subscribing and giving this video a slap on the like thumb. You guys are amazing. It's so exciting to be able to do this series. Even GGG noticed us. So big ups to all my viewers, and as always, stay sane, Exile.